Hello everyone, this is Pastor Paul with the Weekly Devo. Today I wanted to share out of Genesis chapter 17, two separate verses, verse 5 and verse 15. It says, "No longer shall your name be called Abram, but your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations." And then skip down to verse 15, it says, "And God said to Abraham, as for Sarai your wife, you shall not call her name Sarai, but Sarah shall be her name." So this is the infamous story, the famous story of the name changing of Abraham and Sarah. And we also see this sort of name changing kind of happening few generations down from Abraham. Of course, Jacob, as you may know, his name originally meant, actually his name is still called Jacob, but the meaning behind his name, right? It used to be heel catcher, which in their culture that meant kind of like a con man. In a way, it's like, why would you name your child that in the first place? But that was what his name was. But then, of course, after that whole story of Jacob wrestling with God, God actually changed the meaning of the name Jacob to Israel, which meant striving with God, right? So we see this name changing that happens. And with Abraham and Sarah, sort of this idea of name changing. And you know, you may wonder, what is the meaning behind this name change? Well, the name Abram, so Abraham's original name, Abram, meant exalted father. So Abraham, as you can tell, even with the wording, it's not that drastic sort of a difference. He went from exalted father Abram to Abraham, which meant father of multitudes. And it kind of fits the promise, right, of that God gave to Abraham. And he kind of explained that, "But your name shall be Abraham, for I have made you the father of a multitude of nations." And then in verse 15, his wife also got this name change. She went from Sarai, which actually meant my princess. The word Sarai is really the possessive version of the word Sarah. So the possessive part of the name change. So Sarai is sort of my princess, to Sarah, which is just princess. And God said in verse 16, even though we didn't read it, it says, "I will bless her, and moreover, I will give you a son by her. I will bless her, and she shall become nations. Kings of peoples shall come from her." So the change here is that she went from a more restrictive sort of name, right? My princess. You're a princess to a certain household. So you're subscribed to a certain name, certain family, certain household, to Sarah, which was free of any restriction, sort of this general princess, right? And very similar to Abram, because Abram went from exalted father to which is more restrictive, right? Exalted father to a certain family, again, to a certain name, certain household, to Abraham. No, you are a father of a multitude, right? And more specifically, multitude of nations. And so it's basically God bestowing and kind of inscribing almost his promise that he gave to Abraham within the name, right? I said, I'm going to bring a nation. Your descendants will be as numerous as the stars in the sky, as the grains of sands on the seashore. And I'm going to just engrave that almost by changing your name from exalted father to father of multitude. And your wife will also change her name from my princess, a princess of a certain household, to princess. Almost basically the meaning is princess to the whole world, if you will, right? So father figure and mother figure of pretty much nations. That's what's happening here. So by changing their name, God is pretty much saying, my promise overtakes everything. See, because whoever named Abram, when, you know, his father or whoever it was that named Abram, again, sort of had this in mind. It's a kind of glorious name, right? You're going to be an exalted father, you know, to all your descendants that come after you. Yeah, people are going to look up to you, revere you as an exalted father. Right? So it's a great name. Same thing with Sarai. Whoever named Sarai, hey, you're like my princess, right? You're a precious, precious princess, you know, and I'm sure there's idea of like, yeah, we want to raise you like your royalty, right? May you possess the character and then just the benevolence of a royalty you know, may you be a princess, my princess. But then God says, not just a princess to a certain household. No, as you are in the context of my promise, my covenant, you're going to be like a mother figure of nations. Same thing with Abram, not just an exalted father, but you're going to be the exalted father to nations because you're within my covenant. My covenant will come through, and it's my promise will be kept, you know, for good. And so I look at that, if you were to try to apply that to our own lives. See, God does this sort of name changing with us too. When we become believers, when we accept the gospel message, right, and we give our lives unto the Lord and say, Lord, we are your sons and daughters. We want to live for you, right? We are Christians. When we make that promise, when we make that commitment, what we're also committing to is, God, you are our master. We are your servants. We're basically saying we want to be used by God. We want God to take over our lives, and our passion, we want God to bring down our purpose. We want God to be our all in all. That's sort of basically the commitment that we're making as we become Christians. So kind of like Abraham and Sarah in this story, when we become Christians, when we become believers, God does a name change in our lives too. And what I love, again, about this whole story is it's not a sort of this drastic name change where you become someone totally different. But no, Abraham, again, still possessed Abram, right? He's still a father, an exalted father. It's just God. It's just subscribed to God's promise. Same thing with Sarah. She's still a princess, right? Like her name suggested. But now she is tied to the context within the promise of God. And that's exactly who we are. See, when we become Christians, we don't become a completely, you know, different person. You still have your talents. You're still good at certain things. You know, your background, your prior experiences, and all these things that make up who you are still stays with you, right? And you are still good at certain things, not good at certain things. All your gifts and your talents still follow you. But the difference is now everything changes because we are utilizing all of who we are within the context of God's promise, namely the purpose that he has for our lives. We're not just living to glorify ourselves or anyone else, but we're now living to glorify God. We're now living for the name of God. We're now living for expansion of the kingdom of God, as Abraham and Sarah did, right? So we think about this. May we never forget that the most important ingredient to who we are, our identity, and what we do and what we pursue is God. That we want to please God. That we want to carry out the will of God for our lives. And that is the most powerful thing, the most empowering thing that can happen to our lives. And the thing that's going to bring us the most amount of blessings, right? Because that's what we all need to do. Subscribe ourselves to the will of God and his plan for our lives. Lord, we sometimes forget our Maker. We sometimes forget that you created us. And Lord, help us to remember and know that just remembering that fact alone can be so empowering, because we go to the origin. We go to our Maker to find out who we are supposed to be. We go to you to find out our true name, the meaning behind who we truly are. So Lord, help us to find our identity. Help us to find our standing in you. And may your will be done in all of our lives. May your purpose be our purpose. And that is the most satisfactory thing that can happen to our lives. Help us to know and remember that truth. We thank you, Lord. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.